My name is Lindsay Walls, and I'm the founder of Courageous Hearts. When the bridge collapsed, I had a lot of emotions and a lot of things come up. I was sure that I was going to die. When it started to fall, I assumed that I would land on the concrete and my car would splat me on the ground. Like, that was just the way I pictured it, my life ending. That didn't happen. My car ended up landing in the river. And so when it landed in the river, I was faced with a new challenge of being trapped and unable to breathe and feeling like I was going to drown. I was drowning. I wasn't just feeling like it, I was drowning. During those moments of not having air and gasping for breath, I thought a lot about the life that I'd lived and what I had hoped to accomplish in my life and what I wasn't going to, what I thought I wouldn't be able to accomplish, and all the things that, I wouldn't call them regrets, because I felt like I'd lived a life, a good life that far. I had something to be proud of in the life that I'd lived, but there were definitely things, even the dream that I had as a 16-year-old, that I wouldn't get to accomplish. So then, when I got out of my car and was able to breathe again and was able to get to the bridge and just sit there, my dream actually came back to me, and it stuck with me, and it gave me a different kind of meaning to the life that I was kind of given back. And so it became a reason to live again and a reason to keep, to heal and to get better, so that I could make something good out of the bad part that happened. It began in my brain quite a long time ago. I started thinking about having a youth center and being a part of that and starting something like that when I was actually a young person myself at 16. I was involved in starting a youth center out in my hometown community, and it was a really impactful experience for me, and being involved in a leadership position and getting to see how something could begin from the ground up. I thought about it a lot and went into the field of youth work, always with that in the back of my mind as a dream. Ended up trying to be practical about life and find a job just with some other organization, but ultimately I knew that I needed to follow my dream and my heart when I experienced the 35W bridge collapse.
The awesome hands-on classes that are less teaching you how to do something and more giving you a place to do it.
A place where they can go and have fun and learn new things that you wouldn't learn in school.
It's just a place to, I guess you could learn about yourself more.
It's good for the community, and like, it helps people, and especially kids who need that kind of thing. They need help with like certain stuff, and it's kind of relaxing, and it makes it so that you feel like you have a safe place to go.
I like that it's really laid back, and I've been in a couple other groups that are kind of like this, and I just think that this one involves youth the most. Like, I really feel like all the youth in it, like, we have all the power, mostly. Like, we make the decisions.
Probably, it has a inviting feeling to it.
It'll be able to make kids more open and try harder and, like, be able to do art and, like, not just art like painting and stuff like that, but the arts, and like realize that it is actually like an important part of life and a good way to express yourself.
I guess courage would have to be not just like trying things that scare you, but new things, because not all new things scare you in reality, I guess.
Courage is like being able to do something and not really caring about like what other people think, or like just like not being afraid to do it, basically.
Courage to me is probably like being brave, like doing something even if you're scared to do it.
I think courage is, despite what you feel, despite like if you're scared, you're still willing to do something even though like you feel like you can't almost, like you rise above what you feel to accomplish something.
Have courage. Join or donate to Courageous Hearts today.
I didn't think much of street art, actually.
When we first started talking about graffiti and street art, I wasn't opposed to it.
And, well, graffiti in my brain was negative.
I was more so opposed to it on places where people like my parents had to clean it off.
Everyone says, oh no, graffiti is not a style, it's a bad way to use stuff with paint. Like with me, I grew up like hanging out with my brothers while he painted. So I've seen a lot of good things.
I don't really like tagging, but like if they do like a big mural or stuff like that, like down by the river and on the bridges, there's some really cool stuff.
So we got a grant through the Center for Urban and Regional Affairs to work with the Standish Erickson Neighborhood Association around projecting youth voice into the community. And we were gonna do that through an art project. And so we worked with Forecast Public Art and did a lot of conversations with the Youth Advisory Board about things that are interesting to them, things that they care about, and something that kind of rose to the surface and there was a lot of interest in was the idea of street art. We had so many questions and we were initially thinking, oh, do we have to have an answer and come up with a project that has an answer to it? And then we decided, no, we can just ask a lot of questions.
I do remember when we were having the discussion on like who gets to define what graffiti and street art is and what the difference is. I had never thought about that. I was like, oh, well, my dad says it's this, and he is right because it is on his building.
Graffiti to me is a painting style using like paint cans, kind of make something beautiful out of something that wasn't so beautiful. I've seen the bad side of it, but I wouldn't call it graffiti. I would just call it people terrorizing their neighborhood.
I do think differently. I do notice it a lot more than I did before. I think more about it. I think more deeply into the whole situation, like whenever I walk by something, like, was this supposed to be there? Was this allowed? When is it gonna get taken down? Who put it there? Why'd they put it there?
I'm excited to hear what people think about it, like, because you know, you don't know who everyone think is what is art and what is not.
It's just kind of like a pretty controversial topic.
Maybe it's not black or white, but it's somewhere in the gray.
Lindsay Walls started dreaming of creating her own youth center when she was 16 years old. She went to school to specifically get into a field of working with youth, then on her way home from her job with at-risk youth on August 1st of 2007, the unimaginable happened. The 35W bridge collapsed, and with it, her dreams of that youth center, or so she thought.
It actually crossed my mind that day when I was sitting on the bridge waiting for help to arrive, and I thought about why I was still alive, and I wondered if maybe I had a mission that hadn't been accomplished yet.
Months of rehabilitation helped get Lindsay back toward being healthy physically, but the mental impact of the incident kept her from even being able to shower without fear of the water. Then Walls found a flyer for a class called Soul Painting, a class not about technique, just about doing the work. With relatives that had used art to heal from traumatic events in their lives, Lindsay decided to go to the class ready to heal and to paint what she was going through internally on paper and even her own back brace after she had physically recovered. 3 years after the collapse, Lindsay started thinking about her dream job once again, and with the new component of art in her life, she started the plans for Courageous Hearts to become a reality.
To me, healing is all about courage, and so Courageous Hearts is a space where kids get to develop courage, and that mean trying out a new art skill that they don't feel comfortable with, or they think they're not an artist because they only draw stick figures. I've heard that more than once, where they just get to try new things and explore who they are and hopefully build a strong heart in the process.
Okay.
Since August, she's taught kids that it is all about the process and not the end result through arts such as painting, beading, music, and even yoga. Letting the kids know that it is not about a skill, it's about a story.
Really just wanting to give them that place and that space to have a different way to cope and a different way to heal if they need to.
I found it really like comfortable to do things here, and I didn't feel like I was being judged at all, and I thought it was easy for me to express myself in the way that I thought was right.
The philosophies of Courageous Hearts made it easy for Lindsay to attract volunteers to help the fledgling organization and fulfill others' dreams as well, all through the joy of creation.
We facilitate healing naturally. It just happens. And to be able to do that with kids and with a kid-centered, kid-driven agency, it's like a dream come true.
Courageous Hearts is still in its infancy, but it's gaining national attention for the work they're doing with art and the guidance they're providing. The Arts and Healing Network recognize people around the world annually who either personally experience the healing power of art or are giving that experience to other people with a $5,000 grant with their Honoring the Next Generation Award. After just a handful of months being up and running, Walls' story and contributions earned her the distinction already. The grant money is welcome, too, as Courageous Hearts is on a shoestring budget at this point. But her volunteers see Walls' efforts and are giving her all the support they can.
Lindsay has more drive, more commitment, more authenticity than almost anyone that I know. She puts her mind to it, and she does it. So she has single-handedly been the founder, been the janitor, she's doing everything.
Survivor's guilt haunted Lindsay for months. But she says this project isn't just for her. It's for the 13 people that didn't survive that August day.
For me, this is about them as much as it's about my own life and my own dream. It's about living every day to the fullest. I think that that's the biggest lesson that that the bridge taught me, is just to live and to know that I have other people that I can live for too, and that their lives are not lost, and that, you know, their memory can live forward in this as well, even though I didn't get the fortune to know them.
And now her dream will continue to keep the next generation dreaming. In Minneapolis, Eric Lind, KEYC News 12.